As far as Puritans go, Richard Sibbes was far from prolific. During his lifetime, he authorized the publishing of only 3 works. By most standards, his theology was modest, but hardly robust. He never married, he had no progeny, and for the entirety of his life, he ministered without controversy in a rapidly deteriorating ecclesiastical context. In fact, it would be easy to categorize Sibbes' life and ministry as fairly mundane. Yet, for all that was seemingly mediocre about his ministry, it's hard to deny that very few Puritans commanded the kind of admiration and respect which Sibbes enjoyed. Those who knew him well called him by affectionate nicknames such as the Heavenly Doctor and the Sweet Dropper. Zachary Catlin, a contemporary biographer of Sibbes, wrote of him that no man that I ever was acquainted with got so far into my heart and lay so close therein. While he might have lacked the intelligence of, say, an Edwards or the conviction of Bunyan, or even the theological acuity of Owen, Sibbes towered above all others as a purveyor of spiritual comfort. And so there's little doubt that there's much insight to be gained from examining the spiritual tenor of the life and ministry of one of the most renowned and cherished Puritans of all time. Richard Sibbes was born in 1577 in Tostock, Suffolk. Sibbes was the firstborn among 11 children. His father, Paul, was a wheelwright by trade and was said to have been a good, sound-hearted Christian. Sibbes' father had hoped that young Richard would one day take over his trade, and so he made preparations for him to receive the minimum amount of education necessary. Once he began his studies, however, it became readily apparent that Sibbes had a greater affinity for books than for his father's tools. In spite of his father's hopes, wishes, and means, Richard was so proficient in his studies that in 1595 he was able to obtain the patronage of some local benefactors who secured his entry as a sizar into St. John's College, Cambridge. Sibbes entered Cambridge during a period of obvious political and religious flux, especially over the issue of conformity. There's little doubt that he was impacted by the controversies that filled the air, some of them more meaningful, others clearly needless. In spite of this growing discontentment, the influence of the Lambeth Articles had cultivated an environment of soteriological Calvinism in both Cambridge and the Church of England, and it was this environment which was formative for Sibbes' effective Calvinism. Sibbes earned his Bachelor of Arts degree in 1599, a fellowship in 1601, an MA in 1602, and shortly after this, in 1603, Sibbes was converted through the preaching of Paul Baines. In 1607, Sibbes was officially ordained into the Church of England, and he completed his Bachelor of Divinity degree in 1610. From 1611 to 1616, he served as a lecturer of Holy Trinity Church in Cambridge, and his success here eventually afforded him the opportunity to take up the prestigious lectureship of Gray's Inn in London. In spite of this, Sibbes' appetite for academics could hardly keep him away from Cambridge, and in 1626, Sibbes took on the position of Master at St. Catherine's College, while also earning his Doctor of Divinity. In 1633, King Charles I himself appointed Sibbes to once again take up the lectureship of Holy Trinity. Sibbes continued to discharge both lectureships while maintaining his responsibility at St. Catherine's until his death 2 years later, in July of 1635. Although Sibbes never married, he was an eminently likable and humble minister who managed to gain a wealth of friendships among some of the most godly and influential persons of Stuart-era England. Although it is apparent from Sibbes' sermons and writings that he was decidedly Calvinistic and a Puritan, and in spite of some previously muddled biographies, Mark Dever has convincingly demonstrated in his biography of Sibbes that he was a man of conscientious, moderate conformity to the Church of England, living in the waning era of Elizabethan settlement. Despite, at times, serious reservations about the ritual aspects of the Book of Common Prayer and the various relationships with nonconformists and separatists alike, Sibbes consciously subscribed to the 3 canon articles on at least 2 different occasions, and he maintained a peaceful and rightly regarded ministry his entire life. J.I. Packer remarked that by the time of his death, Sibbes had positioned himself throughout as a man of peace, a reforming conformist, and a pioneer in good causes for the furthering of the gospel. As we can see, Sibbes was an influential theologian and minister, and there are many important themes and ideas present in his life that we can focus on. But, for the purposes of this lecture, I'd like to hone in on one particular theme in Sibbes' life and ministry. I can think of no better description of this theme than that provided by Benjamin Brook, who said of Sibbes that he was of a mild, quiet, and peaceable spirit, always unwilling to provoke superiors. He was a burning, shining light, spending himself for the profit of others. On all occasions, he was very charitable to the poor of Christ's flock, and not only was his purse open to their needs, but his soul was commensurated in their spiritual necessities. He was zealous and faithful steward of God's grace. Sedgwick aptly summarizes this burning and shining love with a simple term, amiable living. Over the course of this lecture, I hope to show that the amiable character of Sibbes' ministry was not merely the result of some likable personality or just disposition, but that it was conscientiously central feature of his spirituality. In the end, we'll see two things. First, that Sibbes' intentional benevolence and humility rose out of deep theological convictions which Sibbes held. Second, we will see the way in which this amiable living characterized so much of what Sibbes had to say and so much of what he did. In order to discern its effects, we must begin by looking at the three theological convictions which acted as springs of this amiable living in Sibbes' heart and mind. As a quick preceding note, we must realize that soteriological Calvinism was and should be an assumed element of these considerations. So first, if we're to understand Sibbes' benevolence and charity, we must start with his theological conviction regarding the Trinity. Sibbes often spoke about the triune community as a wellspring of love and generosity. In fact, Sibbes saw God's triune relational love as the basis for both creation and redemption, and he would often celebrate what he called God's spreading goodness. As a Christian, Sibbes saw nothing higher than experiencing the love of the triune community. But this love was not merely something to be pursued, but was also something by its very nature that was to be shared. And so Sibbes was motivated to externalize that love, to share it, to nurture it, and most importantly, maintain it in his fellow Christians. Sibbes argued that the Trinity should be the pattern of our unity, because I say all good is in union, and all that comes from us that is accepted of God must be in peace and union. Second, in order to understand the humility and compassion which mark Sibbes' piety, we must recognize the centrality of the person of Christ in his theology. William Black summarizes it well when he says that Sibbes writes and preaches as a man constrained and compelled by the love of Christ. He cannot know enough about Christ, for more than anything else, Christ defined his existence, and he has found Christ to be the source of everything good and needful. Sibbes seemed to be particularly fond of the doctrine of the Incarnation. One author noted that his thoughts and his preaching were so much directed to the humiliation of Christ that it seemed to beget in him a deep humility before men and God. Nothing seemed to move Sibbes more in his characteristic moderation like his considerations of Christ. Finally, if the Trinity was the foundation, Christ the center, then we can rightly say that the proximate cause of his effective piety was his belief and experience of the indwelling presence of the Spirit. Sibbes wrote, "He, the Spirit, sanctifieth and purifieth, and doth all from the Father and the Son, knit us to the Father and the Son, to the Son first and then to the Father, because all the communion we have with God is by the Holy Ghost. All the communion that Christ as man had with God was by the Holy Ghost. And all the communion that God had with us and we with God is by the Holy Ghost. For the Spirit is the bond of union between Christ and us and God and us." So we see that for Sibbes, the Spirit brought the triune goodness and love to bear on the innermost part of our soul. But more importantly, Sibbes was convinced that our ability to love others could only come by the Spirit. When describing this, Sibbes loved to use the imagery of an instrument. He remarked, "We are like wind instruments. Indeed, we sound, but no further than we're blown upon. We yield music, but no further than we're touched by the Spirit." He continues, "Let us lay open our lives to the Spirit's touch. When the Spirit has ruling sway in our lives, he fine-tunes our souls like a musical instrument and plays our lives as a concerto before God." Sibbes saw in the Spirit's indwelling a pattern for our own humility. "The Holy Ghost is content to dwell in smoky and offensive souls," he said. "Oh, that the Spirit would breathe into our spirits a similar disposition." So we see in each of these three things, theological convictions acting as a kind of concentric outworking. The Father is the ground of God's Trinitarian spreading goodness, the Son the center, and the Spirit the direct agent who sheds the love of God abroad in our hearts. Now that we've seen something of the theology behind Sibbes' heartfelt ministry, I want to conclude by briefly examining some of the more important ways in which Sibbes' effective Calvinism influenced his writing and ministry. First, there could be little doubt that this amiability influenced the role which comfort and assurance played in Sibbes' ministry. Probably the best example of this is found in Sibbes' most famous work, The Bruised Reed. The theme of comfort is evident throughout The Bruised Reed. Black himself noted that The Bruised Reed was not written in the heat of academic debate, but in the heat of pastoral concern, at the desire and for the good of weaker Christians. This desire and striving to bring comfort and assurance to the hearts of his hearers was the abiding practical principle of Sibbes' ministry. He was apt to criticize other ministers who seemed more willing to leave people under heavy conviction than to bring them to consolation in the gospel. Lars Zipf has written that the difference between Sibbes and William Perkins was that Sibbes was not a powerful theologian. He was rather a spiritual counselor, what his colleagues called a physician of the soul. Eamon Duffy remarked that Sibbes was a doctor of souls, ministering to the broken hearts of converted sinners. The second major effect of Sibbes' amiable living was that he enjoyed a significant social and ministerial success. Even from his earliest days as a lecturer at Holy Trinity, Sibbes was so well respected that a gallery had to be built in his church to accommodate the number of weekly visitors. This was something that became necessary to Gray's Inn as well. Every church that Sibbes ministered to benefited significantly from his preaching. Regardless of his moderate conformity, Sibbes was an inspiration to his brethren, whether they were Anglican, Presbyterian, or Independents. At one point or another, Sibbes had men such as Francis Bacon, George Herbert, John Cotton, and John Milton as his auditors. Everyone from lawyers to nobility to the gentry, and even the commonest of citizens, flocked to hear his preaching and seek comfort in his words. Sibbes saw much value in a winning and gaining disposition, and he lamented that so few ministers equipped themselves with the same heart as Paul in 1 Corinthians 9. Perhaps most importantly, Sibbes' winning reputation always seemed to guard him against persecution. Finally, perhaps the most interesting way that Sibbes' amiable living affected his ministry was in relationship to his conformity. To examine the complexity of Sibbes' reasons for remaining in conformity would be well beyond the scope of this presentation. But it is sufficient for our purposes to acknowledge that a great part of Sibbes' lifelong loyalty to the established church was rooted in his conscientious affection of piety. Sibbes believed that the Anglican church, for all its faults, was a true church, because it preached the word rightly and administered the sacraments rightly. Because of this, whatever scruples he had were never worth the damage of nonconformity and separation, especially as they would affect the most simplest members of his church. Besides, as Dever notes, Sibbes' concern for inward piety is shown to have been for him not an avenue for nonconformity, but rather that which allowed him to continue in conformity. In other words, Sibbes felt that rather than to remove himself, it was his obligation to remain within the church so that he could stir up the people and educate them. The weakness and impurities of the church were not to him grounds for leaving, because the Church of Christ, as he said, was a common hospital. All are in some measure sick of some spiritual disease or another. We should have the ground of exercising mutually a spirit of wisdom and meekness towards all at all times. It is revealing that Sibbes could say that in some cases peace is of more consequence than the open discovery of some things that we take even to be true. Sibbes concluded for himself that I had rather hazard the censure of some than hinder the good of others. None of this is to say that had Sibbes lived through the decades that followed, he would not have eventually conceded in the face of mounting corruption. He certainly understood and respected the motivation of the nonconformists. But in his day, a day which he called the best times of the gospel, he simply wasn't ready to give up on the Anglican Church. So we can see and we can understand that Sibbes had a deep and abiding love for his church. And it's this deep and abiding love which kept him committed in spite of what even others rightly saw as problems in that church. In conclusion, having looked at the theology which inflamed Sibbes' heart and the way in which that flame shaped his life and ministry, we see a man whose inward piety was externalized by the love and devotion that he consistently demonstrated towards others. Sibbes' abiding love and devotion to the church was remarkable. He warmly and winsomely had a disposition and compassion towards those burdened by the weight of sin that undermined almost any contemporary stereotype regarding a Puritan. Whatever we might make of Sibbes' conformity, surely we must see that peace, humility, love, and meekness saturated his spirituality. It is of little wonder that Isaac Walton could say of Sibbes, "Of this blessed man, let this just praise be given. Heaven was in him before he was in heaven."